bus priests that look like me, Father Quinn. And Father Quinn wouldn't wear his little priest outfit, his little suit. He'd wear his cassock. So he had that long, and he had a little bit of, just a tiny bit of a brogue. And he'd say, "Oh, you Walshes, come here. Come here. I know you're straight away from us, but we'll get you back. Go on, you little darlings, go on." And he'd let us go. We wouldn't have to cross the street. Father Quinn was there, and he loved us. Why would I tell you that story? Because at the missionary workers' mission where we went, this is what I got on Thursday nights. "Blessed is the man," Thursday afternoon, "blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the secret school. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. He is like a tree planted by rivers of water." You see, I got a teaching. The first scripture I ever memorized in my life, I couldn't remember, was Psalms 1. It's meant something ever since those elementary school days. Because somebody was faithful to teach me that there's a difference in life. So they also taught me, "I met Jesus at the crossroads where the two ways meet. Satan too was standing there and he said, 'Come this way. Lots and lots of pleasures I will give to you today.' But I said, 'No. There's Jesus here, see what he offers me. Down here my sins forgiven, up there a home in heaven. Thank God, that's the way for me.'" It's why I ended up in I learned a faith. I learned to do what is right. Not because somebody told me, but because I read the scriptures and allowed God to speak to my heart. As we look at this morning, I want you to ask yourself, am I somebody that is walking the way God wants me to? Am I somebody who is standing the way God wants me to? When I'm sitting around, am I sitting around like someone who God wants to sit around the right way? Only two paths of life lay before us, God's way of obedience or the way of rebellion and destruction. Be sure to choose God's path, because the path you choose determines how you will spend eternity. I'd hate to do it on a hope or a maybe. You ever seen one of those interviews? I've seen them. Where people walk up to somebody in the street, "Do you believe in heaven?"
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay. Think you'll get there?
Yeah, I don't know.
Really? Man, if that's eternity, if you're betting your hopes on eternity, on a I'd be scared to death. I'd be scared to death. The writer here begins this psalm by telling of the joys of obeying God and refusing to listen to those who discredit or ridicule him. This isn't no maybe stuff. This is guaranteed stuff. God is guaranteeing that he'll take care of us. Our friends and associates can have a profound influence on us, by the way. And that's what this is alluding to. Are we hanging out with the unrighteous? Are we hanging out with the wicked or the way of sinners or the seed scoffers? Are we hanging out with those people who just don't want to do anything with God? Is our posse, that's a new expression I learned the last 10 years. Is our group, our friends, our cohorts, are they all believers? Am I the only one that shows up that's putting faith in God? And when I'm hanging out with them, I just kind of keep quiet? If we insist on friendships with those who mock what God considers important, we might even sin by becoming indifferent to God's will. Is this the kind of people I hang out with? This attitude is the same as mocking, by the way. So those three things that the psalmist starts out with right away, if we're hanging out with a crowd that, man, you and your God, we may be mocking God ourselves.
by saying we are believers. Do your friends build up your faith? Do the people you hang out with outside of church and outside of work or whatever, do they build up your faith? Are they the kind of people that you can, or do they tear it down? Well, you know, we love you, but you know, we love you even though you're one of those Bible thumpers. You know, we like you even though you wear that cross. We like you. You're one of us. Really? Maybe I am. Maybe I am. True friends should help you to draw closer to God, not hinder your relationship with Him. And that's what the psalmist is talking about, walking here. Walking in the wrong direction can be such an awful experience, especially this present day. In this time and place, it's awful. The complications for finding your bearing will have you looking in all the wrong places. I think of, there was a thing on Saturday Night Live there years ago. Eddie Murphy would make fun of, I can't even remember the character from the Little Gang series back in the 1930s. And looking for love in all the wrong places. Yeah, buckwheat. He'd do buckwheat. Well, guess what? You're hanging out with the wrong crowd. You're going to be looking for God in all the wrong places. So think of this. Sometimes when we allow God to work in our lives, if we apply ourselves to the Word, if we look at like Psalms 1, if we take it home and read it, and we look at these six verses, the first three are talking about the righteous man, the next three are talking about the unrighteous man. If we look at them, we realize God can work in our lives. It's like the woman that was on the beach, on the state park, and she watched the ranger come along, the park ranger, and grab a hold of a 300-pound loggerhead turtle that had laid its eggs and now was headed inland instead of back. It had lost its direction. But the soil was still sandy enough, and he knew how to do this because he'd done it before. He kind of played with it, and all of a sudden he got at the tip and he flipped it on its back. And once you flip that 300-pound turtle on your back, you can spin it around, do anything. He got one of those long tow ropes, you know, those tow lines. He wrestled it around the turtle and hooked it up to the back of his four-wheel drive pickup and started dragging the turtle back to the beach. And he spun it around again, and with the help of others, flipped it. Once the turtle realized there's the water, it was gone. For some of us, when you're on your back being turned every which way but loose, you don't know whether God is doing you in or delivering you. Sometimes when you have those questions, when he puts you to lie in a certain spot while he puts the tow rope around you, you don't know which way is up and you're laying flat on your back. When we walk with him and not to the advice of the world, God will take care of us. See, God gets the credit for putting us on our backs to fix whatever is wrong and make us totally, totally right again. He will put us in a place where there's only room for him, for one God. So often we get drug away, and that's what the psalmist is talking about. He says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked. Standing. Talks about standing here. What kind of crowd are you a part of? One of the things that always amazed me when we were in Haiti some 30-some-odd years ago, and Candy was talking about the Smiths in Haiti. If you saw maybe 6 or 7 or 8 Haitians standing in a circle somewhere, I can guarantee you that when they walk away, there will be a pile of mango seeds. People would stand and they would gather. If somebody had a bunch of mangoes and shared it with their friends, they'd all stand in a little circle. You see this circle of people and they're just eating whatever. When they walk away, they leave this little pile of seeds just leaving it. And if you eat mangoes, if you like, I love mangoes. If you eat mangoes, they've got a great big seed and you're shaped like the mango itself. And I always laugh because why would you do that? customs are different, the people there are kind of trying to survive, and I can't imagine the horrific situation that's going on there right now in Haiti. I was offered a chance this week that maybe we would develop a trip somewhere in the future to go from the DR and cross into Haiti and come back. And I would relish to do that. I would love to do that. Debbie's heard this for the first time right now, so I'm looking at that stare. And I said, well, develop it and we'll see what it looks like. But you know what? When there's a crowd, you knew those people. What were they standing for? So he's talking about standing here. So what kind of a crowd are you part of? Are you standing around eating mangoes? Or are you in a crowd that doesn't care about God? Are you a member of a group who doesn't honor God? Who has no faith in Jesus Christ? Or they're not planning to be involved in the things of God? You know, you see the advice of the world, and that says that they'll take care of ourselves. We can do this. Yeah, your God thoughts sound good, but I've done pretty good without a God, thank you very much. I've got this life pretty well figured out. Well, for some of those people that I've heard say those things over the years, I'd like to ask them, well, how's that working out for you? How's that working out for you? When you hit the fan, where do you turn? Go down the basement and blow the dust off the old Ouija board. You get the Monopoly table out and figure out who's going to get the right roll of dice. I mean, what are you chancing on? He says here, nor stands in the way of sinners, people who want to go that way. I have a new position. I got hired this week to be the chess coach. Mike's going to come down and cheer with pom-poms. The chess coach for RSU 63, and I was excited about it, but I was thinking, you know, when doing it, that there's a lot to that, but you know, you get the kids excited, you want them excited, you want them to do well and excel, you want their minds to think. And in doing that, you have to ask them certain questions, and you want them in a crowd that thinks about chess. If you're caught up between basketball and soccer and something else, you're not going to be any good sitting in a chess club. Chess club is a thinker's club. And when I was sitting there for my interview, you think about people standing around who are ungodly, I told, and you've heard me, because Herb's got a shirt similar. Number two stepdaughter has that, when she went through Maine law, she had that bumper sticker on her computer, never underestimate the voice of an idiot in a crowd. You know, I said, because the question was given to me, what would you do to take care of an unruly child? You know, they were asking me, how do you handle that? And I explained my philosophy. But I had to quote that bumper sticker. Are you in a group that stands around and has no understanding who God is, and they're willing to be the voice of the idiot in the crowd and lead you that way too? That's something we have to ask ourselves sometimes in our friendships. You see, following the path God puts before us means trusting Him and not the advice of the world. We can't stand with sinners and hope that we're going to get it right. But I've done pretty good without a God, as some people would say, and that always scares me. I've watched so many yearn for things to make them feel good when it comes to God's Word, but they don't apply themselves to God's Word. They listen to the crowd and not hold to the written Word. We trust by faith. Not by sight. A huge crowd was watching the famous Walker Blondin. Blondin was the, who's the guy that jumped the Grand Canyon on the motorcycle?
Evel
Knievel. Blondin was an Evel Knievel guy back in the 1860s. He walked back and forth across a tightrope at Niagara Falls, 1860. And the crowd watched him, a huge crowd. And he crossed it numerous times, a 1,000-foot trip, 1,000 feet, and 160 feet above the water. Imagine that. Da-da, da-da. And he made a lot of trips over that raging water, and he not only walked across it, he also pushed a wheelbarrow across it. Imagine that. And one little boy just stared in amazement. When I'm amazed at something, I usually my mouth drops, and Debbie goes, close mouth. little boy stood there and he goes, you know, he's watching this and back and forth. So as he crossed one time, he noticed a little boy watching and he looked over the little boy. Do you believe I could take a person across in this wheelbarrow without falling? The little boy goes, you know, blonde and said, then get in. Then get in. See, that's what the psalmist is saying, that we're blessed, but we got to get in the wheelbarrow and let God take us across.
Well, did he?
I don't know. Go ask him. It was 1860. That woke you up, didn't it? We have to be willing to get in the wheelbarrow. That's faith. That's trusting him. It's like the old story about the guy who fell off the cliff. And as he went over the cliff, there was a limb right there, and he grabbed the limb, and an angel came along with its big wings. You believe I can save you? The guy said, yeah. And he said, then let go. You know, we've got to trust God. Trusting God is stepping out by faith. One of the most amazing things I've ever thought of is when Israel went to cross the Jordan River. See, God didn't just part the Red Sea, loved ones. If you know your Bible, God did that more than once. And when he parted the Jordan, it was in springtime when the floodwaters were all the way up. And I was thinking about those priests that were carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Because as I've gotten older, my footing isn't as solid as it used to be. I'm very careful where I step and how I step. So you can imagine being a priest on the front, and you're in high water. Where's the drop off? Where's the shore? You know, am I just going to step out? But you step out in faith. The Bible narrative doesn't tell us that anybody got injured. No one dumped into the water. God opened the water because they were willing to put their foot in the water. Peter got out of the boat, and he was sinking when he took his eyes off Jesus. You got to keep your eyes on Jesus. So the psalmist here goes, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. Nor sits in the seat of scoffers. Although a sinner himself, this psalmist knew that he wasn't righteous before God except for the grace that God gave him. He is now a blood-washed sinner. If you and I are believing in Jesus Christ, you are not with the unrighteous. You're with the righteous, and we are made alive by the Holy Spirit and renewed in heart. That's what God does for us in Christ Jesus. And standing by the rich grace of God in the congregation of the righteous, he dares not, you shouldn't, I shouldn't, we dare not hang with the crowd that does evil. I've been in places with guys, and I've had to walk away. And I felt like finding a shower somewhere. It's just a feeling. But the language, you've heard me tell the story about stopping in a local store, and I heard more profanity. And I asked the guy, how come you never say Buddha? Hindu gay. Muhammad, damn. And when I hear you say Jesus, why would you use his name? The guy said, what? Good thing I got a little weight on me. Maybe he thinks I could take him in 3 rounds, you know. He backed him up a little bit. I was offended. Boy, if I said something about somebody who was gay or another political party, from the other side of town, boy, they get offended. When it comes to faith, when it comes to Christianity, so I'm not going to sit in the seat of mockers. And if somebody says something, I want to say that offends me. I have the same rights you have. That offends me. So often, he says it here, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. So often, it's everybody around us. Where do you go? except maybe here on a Sunday morning when you're not hearing that kind of stuff. You see, a real believer finds no rest in the atheist mocking. When you see Ron Reagan get on TV with a national commercial about he's not feared death because he's an atheist, he promotes his national atheistic ideas, and they put it on during a, I think it was, I won't blame any particular party, but the Democrats, I think, were doing it. And he puts this national commercial on. Who cares? You don't care about God, so who cares? And people who believe that there's a way to vote, you let them vote. I don't promote anybody. I say, vote the way God moves your heart by his word. Because I believe that if you're following, like the psalmist here in Psalms 1, you're going to vote correctly. So he finds no rest in the atheist mocking. Let others make a mockery of sin, of eternity, of hell, and of heaven, and the eternal God. This man, the man in the Psalms, has learned better philosophy than that of the lost, and has too much sense of God's presence to endure to hear his name blasphemed. It bothers me. I hope it bothers you. The seat of the scorner may be very lofty, but it is very near to the gate of hell. So you and I should run away from it, for it's going to be soon empty. Destruction shall swallow up the man who sits in it. And that's what the psalmist says. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. It was a lady, Mrs. Monroe, who lived in Darlington, Maryland. She had 8 kids. She came in the house one day to find 5 of the children sitting on the floor in the living room. Each one of them was hugging a baby skunk. She let out a scream. The kids jumped up, each holding their little baby skunk. And she says, "We got to get rid of them." But they didn't understand, and they all fled out of the house, squeezing their little baby skunks. And if you realize or know anything about little baby skunks, they don't like to be squeezed. When we hang around skunks, sometimes we start smelling skunks. And the psalmist says, we are to follow God and not walk in the way of the unbeliever, or stand up in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of mockers, those who make fun of our faith. But our delight is in God's law. So let me close with this poem. He does not lead me year by year, nor even day by day. But step by step my path unfolds. My Lord directs my way. Tomorrow's plans I do not know. I only know this minute. But he will say, this is the way. By faith, now walk you in it. And I am glad that it is so. Today's enough to bear. And when tomorrow comes, his grace shall far exceed. What need to worry then or fret? The God who gave his son holds all my moments in his hand and gives them one by one. Are you trusting in the eternal God this morning? Or are you trusting in yourself? Today, think about that for me, will you? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for giving us a picture of what you desire. Men and women who won't walk with the ungodly, nor stand around with the sinner, nor sit at the seat of the mockers, those who make fun of you. Father, in this place, may your name never be sullied. May we walk according to your word. May we lavish ourselves with the grace that you have given us because of your great love. We pray this.